Elon Musk has got into the debate, if that's what it is, about the EFF again at its 10th birthday celebrations over the weekend, singing the subtle song Kill the Boer, Kill the Farmer, de Boer, de Boer. And Elon Musk posted on X and accused Julius Malema of openly pushing for the genocide of white people in South Africa, and to which Julius Malema responded succinctly, "Bolela masepa, you are talking shit." And I don't think that the EFF singing Kill the Boer, Kill the Farmer in an environment like their 10th birthday celebrations, that rally all of the emotion, I don't think they are openly calling for the genocide of white South Africans. The DA, as was reported yesterday, are taking the matter to the United Nations Human Rights Court. What that's going to achieve, other than position the defender as the DA as the defender of white people, I don't know. Ongama Mtinka is a political analyst, a doctor. Ongama Mtinka joins us now on the line from Klebecha. And where do you position the singing of the song in contemporary South Africa, contemporary South African politics?
So here's the thing. The song was sung in a time when there was a lot of agitations for, you know, dealing with what Amabulu, Boer, translated in isiNtu, agitations for dealing with Amabulu. And indeed, Amabulu meant the system of white supremacy and its brutality. When in the democratic period, obviously the challenge is to deal with the legacies of that system. And those who are arguing for the continued use of the song are saying it's part of that heritage, right? And my view is that actually this song is a relic of the past and we do not need it. In a South Africa in which we are trying to build a united country amidst the divisions that we face in South Africa, racial harmony is crucial, and it's important for us to do so in ways that are not alienating to any section of our society. There are things which rightly divide us, such as, for example, how much redress policies should be there. And those things are emotive. And I think that if we focus our intentions on continuing to differ on those things and actually finding common ground, I hope that we find common ground. And in fact, my view is that the more organizations resist measures to bring about transformation, the more they make the existence of people who exploit grievances, like Julius Malema often does sometimes, you know, the more they create space for that, for such people.
My preference would be for the song not to be sung, but when it is sung, how do we respond to it?
You see, language, John,
yeah,
is first used socially by people before it is defined in courts of law. So if I hear the word kill the farmer, kill the Boer, it definitely means that. It can't mean anything else. Now, it's one thing for a court of law to define the contours and the realm of interpretation that can be used in order to determine when it is offensive and whether it can incite people to violence. My issue, though, is that things that are permissible are not necessarily beneficial. It may be legally permissible, but politically it's not right that people continue to use this divisive language.
And yet the song speaks to the anger that many people feel about the fact that their lives have not transformed. And the argument is that they're not talking about killing an individual white farmer. They're talking about the fact that the system of oppression is still with them, that political freedom hasn't led to economic, housing, social, sewage freedom. And so it's a cry for the system to be killed so that economic freedom comes into their lives. What's the risk of it being interpreted literally?
John, we have enough by way of language to say what we mean and to sing what we mean. I find that these explanations are really not helping. So Mbeki, for example, former President Mbeki, whose explanation before the TRC has been brought about to give context to this, I think that in that period, in the immediate aftermath of 1994 and the close affinity to liberation heritage, including the songs, you could make the point. But what he says in general about what amagwijo mean in his Xhosa is not entirely true. So, for example, there's this song that came around some time ago that says, Uramaphosa uyamthanda umahlalela, he uvela mnike 350. So that means Ramaphosa loves the unemployed. He just gives them 350. So this song came out. That song, actually, its potency is both in the literal meaning and also in the figurative meaning. That, and my argument is that, in likewise, with these songs, with Kill the Boer, Kill the Farmer, there was a time when the literal meaning itself, you know, may not necessarily have referred to a farmer per se, but definitely referred to white people in general, Amabulu. Also, there's the other song that they sing in funerals, Tinaban Bamkondos is Miselo Abulala Amabulu. Every time that song is sung, you would see some people who resist, being uncomfortable, even though, this has been a somber song that used to be sung in exile and during apartheid South Africa when victims of apartheid brutality were being buried. But in the democratic period, that part about killing the Boers, being committed to killing the Boers, is uncomfortable for any person who is a language, who's a Nguni speaking person, unless somebody who actually is very divisive. And by the way, John, in South Africa, the people who exploit grievances tend to love these polarizing messages because it's part of the making of an identity of being the ultimate revolutionaries who don't care or don't pander to white interests. And I think that they do not aid the country as much as, in my view, organizations like AfriForum, when they defend people's rights to use the old flag, actually don't.
Thank you very, very much indeed. Really appreciate that analysis, Dr. Ongama Mtinka, a political analyst on the line to us from Klebecha.
Afternoon Drive with John Maytham
on Cape Talk.